go ahead and be seated. As I mentioned at the beginning of the service, we have a guest with us today, the Reverend Paul Carr.
That's me.
I know his name, and that's, I know some things because he sent us his CV, but why don't you tell us some things about yourself, who you are, how you got to know the Lord, how you got to be here today, whatever else you would. Oh, here you go.
Okay, good morning, brothers and sisters. It's good to be here. I guess you know more about me than I know about you, if you've read my CV. My name's Paul Carr. I'm from England. I'm from the northeast of England, the northern part, so I have quite a distinctive accent compared to perhaps my brother here from the southern part of England. I'm married to Paula. We've been married for 33 years. I know I don't look old enough to have been married 33 years, but I have. She can't be with us, unfortunately. I have two children. I have a son, Benjamin, who is 23, who's a Christmas Day baby. That's been very complicated over the years. So he's 23, and I have a daughter who is 19 to be. And she was born on Candlemas, which is the 2nd of February. We often thought we would try for three children and try and see if we could get Easter Sunday. But Easter's a movable feast, so we stuck with two. How did I become a Christian? Well, that's an interesting story. I became a Christian when I was about 21 as a result of my best friend committing suicide. It's one of those significant events in life that calls you to think about why I was born, is there a God, what happens when I die. That sent me on a journey. I have to say, I didn't choose Christianity. I visited lots of different religious organizations, Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, different spiritualist groups, to find the answers to the questions that I was asking. It seemed to me that Jesus had the answers to all the questions that other religions didn't. My working life, when I left school, my father is disabled, so I left school early at 16 to be the wage earner for my family. I didn't have the opportunity for further education at that time. I spent 10 years in the building trade, in sales and management. I can speak. I have the gift of the gab, if nothing else, in my ministry. I joined the prison service as a governor in 1988. And then spent 8 years working in the prison service. Felt a call to ministry, and I was ordained 22 years ago. I spent 7 years in East London, in a parish that was very multi-ethnic, quite a very challenging but really interesting community. When I arrived, we had four nationalities. In my congregation, there was lots of racism within the church and within the community. That took a lot of working through. But when I left, we had 38 nationalities in my church. So looking around today, I feel very at home with the different cultures and traditions and nationality that I'm sure are present. So I'm currently team rector in the Chelmsford Diocese. I live about 25 minutes train ride from London. I have five churches that I'm responsible for. I have about 600 church members that I oversee with colleagues. My church is called Emmanuel, and on a regular Sunday, we would probably have 250 people worshiping with us. So quite an interesting, challenging, large place to be. I've been there 12 years, and I'm perhaps the Lord is calling me for a change, which is how I find myself here. That's a story in itself. But we perhaps save that for another time. It's okay.
I'm not usually there. We have a guy named Stan who loves to interview people. And I remember one question he always asks is, what does the perfect day, what's your perfect day?
Okay. I thought you were going to, when I have people visiting my church, the question I answer them, what are you most passionate about? What should the church be most passionate about? A perfect day for me, wow. Breakfast, an American-style breakfast with my family. we don't say much to my children nowadays. To satisfy my wife, we would go shopping and have a coffee somewhere. I would watch my football team, Sunderland, who were not doing very well at the moment, but we would probably win, I don't know, the Premier League or something. That would be a great day. I would probably have a Thai meal. I like Thai, so that would be my evening meal. And I would probably want to go to a concert. And I guess I probably want to go and see one of my favorite artists, a man called James Taylor. He's an American singer-songwriter. So that's probably ish, a bit of a perfect day.
That was a good day.
You're very welcome to join me.
Can I pray for you?
You certainly can, thank you.
Heavenly Father, thank you so much that you're a God who speaks. That in these last days you've revealed yourself in Jesus. Speak to us now, God. Thank you for accepting us just as we are, meeting us where we're at. I pray that you'd speak through our friend here, Reverend Paul. And we are open to your work in our hearts and in our minds. I pray that you'd mold and shape us through everything that goes on the rest of this service. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, friend. Record me.
I didn't set this up. I have to record you, yes.
Okay. Because the bishop said
people,
so.
Yes, people want it done.
And I'm being videoed here as well. I mean, I'm glad you got my frontal view rather than my side view. Well, it's a real joy for me to be here. Quite unexpected, I have to say. Maybe tell that story another time. Actually, when I begin to preach, I've been a preacher for over 20 years, and I always begin with the same prayer. Wherever I preach, it's the same prayer, and it's a response prayer. So I pray a few words, and you respond with the word that I've said. I often say this is a dangerous prayer to preach. You'll understand that when I pray it. So let's just bow our heads and just repeat the words that I pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. By the power of your Holy Spirit, may you speak to my heart and change my life. In the precious name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. I say it's a dangerous prayer because we're asking God through his word to change our life. And isn't that the purpose of fellowship? Isn't that the purpose of meeting together? Isn't that the purpose of the preacher? That I can speak something of God's word into your heart that will change your life. Change something the way that you live, the way that you would leave this place this morning. And if that doesn't happen, then I've wasted my time. But more importantly, I've wasted your time. And that's not the position we want to find ourselves. I nearly said on a Sunday morning, on a Friday morning, as we worship together. I want to, if some people like titles, if you want a title for my talk this morning, it's quite simply The Hope of the Wise Men. The Hope of the Wise Men. But hope is such a powerful word. It can lift our spirits when we're feeling down. It gives us something to cling to when we lose our jobs. Gives us something to cling to when we lose our health or someone we love. Hope is a spark inside our soul that tells us that tomorrow things will be better. I just read the Archbishop of Canterbury's New Year message. I don't know if any of you have read it, and he talks about hope, how hope is such an important word in today's world. And the onset of a new year, and indeed the onset of a new decade, can often be a season of hope. I hope I find a job this year. I hope I pass my exams this year. I hope I beat my illness this year. I hope this year will bring more happiness than sadness. And the list could go on, isn't it? Things that you would hope for in the year to come. But the Bible talks a lot about hope, and it's always inextricably linked to the coming of the Messiah, the Lord Jesus. And in the Lord Jesus, we have the hope of his guidance, his provision, and his care every day of our lives, but also for the life to come. It's the kind of hope which I think gave strength to the wise men on their journey. And this morning I just want to think about three types of hope the wise men experienced. They found hope in God's guidance, they found hope in God's word, and they found hope in worshipping Jesus. Now we know very little about the wise men, or magi, or magi, except that they were came from the east to visit Jerusalem. People tend to think there was three of them because of the three gifts associated with them, but the answer is we don't really know. Legend suggests that they originated from Arabia, from Persia, from India, but they would probably have been educated in the wisdom of the Babylonians and Persians, and may even have studied the ancient book of Daniel with its prophecies of the coming Messiah. They would have had some knowledge, perhaps, of what was to come. A headline in a national newspaper before I left the UK, referring to astrology and alignment of the planets in 2020, said that we should all look forward to, quote, a heavenly event to transform your world. That was the headline. A heavenly event to transform your world. I thought it was a Christian article. I'm thinking, wow, an epiphany article in the national newspaper. But it actually was talking about star signs and astrology and people who live their lives reading their stars day by day. And whilst it was talking about star signs, I couldn't help but be reminded that 2,000 years ago, a heavenly event took place that did indeed transform our world in a way that reading your stars never would. But the star in our reading from Matthew 2 first appeared before Jesus was born. And regardless of whether God used an existing astronomical phenomenon or created one for the occasion, it had a supernatural purpose, and that God was using this to guide the wise men in a very special way. And they, of course, were curious to find where it may have been leading. And it was common practice in those days to link astronomical happenings to the birth of great men and women. So the wise men knew something was taking place. They were looking for a king who would bring an end to war and suffering, a king who would bring an end to injustice. And they were hoping to find this promised king who would bring everlasting love and joy and peace to this world. During an interview before his death on the 29th of November 2001, after fighting a long battle with cancer, former Beatle George Harrison was interviewed by a Rolling Stone magazine about the important issues in his life. And this is what he said. Everything in life can wait, but the search for God cannot wait. Everything in life can wait, but the search for God cannot wait. And that's so true, isn't it? The search for God is without a doubt the most important issue each one of us will face in our lives. We may think we have lots of difficult decisions to make on a daily basis. It may be in our workplace, maybe in our community, it may be in our family. But the decision that we make about whether we follow Jesus or not is the most important decision we will ever, ever make. So the wise men found hope in God's guidance. Now, I don't know about you, but when I'm searching for information, I tend to use the internet long before I'd ever choose a dictionary or an encyclopedia. I have quite a large study, not as large as Bishop Mania's, I have to say. What an amazing study that is. But I probably have as many books as he has, but I don't even use them that often nowadays, much to my shame. I go to the internet rather than a dictionary, a commentary, or an encyclopedia. And just last week, I typed the word God in the Google search engine just to see what would happen. And it gave me a choice of 4.16 billion sites that had something to say about God. 4.16 billion websites that mention God. And it found them in 0.45 seconds. I mean, I don't know what's more amazing, the time that it took to find it, or how many websites you can search. When there's so much information out there, how can we know what is true? How can we know what is false? And in a world of so many conflicting voices, both political and religious, where do we start looking? Well, I guess we say that the answer is in the way the wise men found hope in God's word. They didn't discover the answers to their questions until they consulted the Holy Scriptures. In Matthew 2, the wise men asked, "Where is the one who has been born the King of the Jews?" Herod didn't seem to know, and so he asked the chief priests and teachers of the law where the Messiah was to be born. They didn't really know, but they read from the prophet Micah, and they found their answer, Bethlehem in the land of Judah. So the wise men found Jesus because they searched for the answers in God's word, in the writings of the Old Testament prophets. They may not have thought that's where the answer was going to be found, but it was when the Holy Scriptures were consulted. And like Herod, many people in our world today may have a general idea where Jesus may be found. Church isn't a bad place to start. But until we, like the wise men, consult God's word, we will never find the Jesus of the Bible and the promise of hope that he brings to us. I say this because the Bible is God's guidebook for life. In the UK, we have something called the Highway Code, and we're not allowed to start driving on the road until we pass this. We've done a theory exam, so we understand something of what it means to drive safely and carefully. And only then are we allowed to get in a car by ourselves. I can't help but wonder, is there such a thing in Egypt? The Highway Code? I've been in a car quite a bit these last few days. There doesn't seem to be any rules or regulations at all about how, or maybe there is, and people just ignore it when you pass your test. But just as we wouldn't drive a car without understanding what road signs mean and give way to people on the right and how we deal with pedestrians on the road, we shouldn't embark on a spiritual journey without God's word to guide us. And the point is, we make a mess of our Christian lives if we fail to consult God's word. And whilst it can often be painful to do so, because God's word challenges our values, it challenges our morals, challenges our ethics, but it also brings us life in all its fullness as we find ourselves being nurtured and strengthened by its truth. But of course, a formal knowledge of the Bible doesn't lead us to knowing who Jesus is. It didn't for Herod and his attendants, and it certainly won't for us. We have to take that further step by trusting in the God of the Bible, by trusting in the promised Messiah that comes from God. And so if I have a prayer for you this morning, it is that those of you who are unsure of your faith in Jesus, and even those of you who are, will make a point of reading carefully and examining God's word in the year to come, because in doing this, you will find the fullness of hope, the fullness of God's hope for your life. You won't need to go to a website or the 4.16 billion that exist. You can read it for yourself and allow His Spirit to nurture and grow your faith. So the wise men found hope in God's guidance, hope in His word, but they also found hope in worshiping Jesus. And the three gifts they offered, mentioned by the psalmist and Isaiah, were deeply spiritual gifts. Gold as a symbol of kingship, incense a symbol of divinity, and myrrh a symbol of death. I guess they would have no idea the significance of those gifts when they were carrying and taking them to the king that they were looking for. But wow, had God not just touched their hearts at the very beginning when they set out on their journey? Why are you carrying this? What does this mean? And they may not have known the fulfillment of that in their own lives. Yet with hindsight and with history, we know fully how prophetic those gifts were that they brought to Jesus. But I find it quite amazing that these men, I'm assuming they were men, there may have been women amongst them, I don't know. But I find it quite amazing that these three men were willing to travel thousands of miles to worship a king that wasn't even their own. But Isaiah prophesied this in verse 3 of chapter 60 when he said, "Nations shall come to your light and kings to the brightness of your dawn." I had a look around the cathedral on my own last night. It's quite something different to be in a church on your own, and the quietness of the space and the peace of God's presence. I had a little walk around and looked around behind, and I was just noticing the chairs. I don't know what you call them, chairs, or the canon seats or something like that. And just looking at the names of all the saints, and I noticed there's a seat there to Saint Augustine, which I thought was quite interesting, because I'm going to quote Saint Augustine now. He wrote a sermon on the Epiphany of Christ many years ago, and this is what he said. "Though many kings of the Jews had been born and died, none of them did the Magi seek to adore. And so they who came from a distant foreign land to a kingdom that was entirely strange to them had no idea of showing such a great homage to such a king as the Jews were wont to have, but they had learned that such a king was born, and that by adoring him they might be sure of obtaining from him the salvation which is of God." When we worship the king who is the King of Kings, we obtain the salvation which comes from God. I often think that this journey for the wise men was the fulfillment of a personal quest, a pilgrimage for truth, a journey that would change their lives forever. And how amazing it is that these Gentile kings were amongst the first to bend their knees in worship to a king that they had met for the first time. Paul echoed this in Ephesians 3:6 when he said, "The Gentiles share in the promise of Christ Jesus through the gospel." Psalm 72 talks about all kings bowing down before him. But in closing, someone once wrote, "Totally without hope, one cannot live. To live without hope is to cease to live. Totally without hope, one cannot live. To live without hope is to cease to live." And that's so true in so many different ways if we apply that premise to our lives. But in the difficult and often confusing world in which we live, hope for many people is something that seems to be in such short supply. In fact, I would even go so far as to say that in a world of pain, in a world of grief, in a world of sorrow, in a world of complex family relationships, of problems at work, in our communities, alongside many other hardships of life, hope for many people has simply died a death. But hope, I believe, is one of the most important gifts God gives to us. And nothing brings hope back to life like the story of the wise men and the hope that I'm suggesting they had in their hearts. And the message of Epiphany gives us hope that in an often bewildering world, hope to face the uncertainties of the future. And this hope for our world and for ourselves is found in the face of a child born in a stable. You couldn't write the script, could you? And yet, we believe it to be true. Epiphany reminds us that Jesus came to be the savior of all peoples, but it wouldn't be without a cost, for it cost Jesus his life, a sacrifice he was willing to make for our salvation. But as we begin a new year, and as we face a new decade, have you ever thought about what God's hopes might be for you? And no matter how extravagant your own hopes and New Year's resolutions might be, what hopes God has for you is much more valuable. I think God hopes that you will believe in his son Jesus, so that he can give you hope and meaning for your life today. God hopes that you will allow him to safely guide you each step of your journey through life, however young, however old you may be, however long established, or however new you might be as a Christian. God hopes that you will trust in his word to enable you to grow in your faith. God hopes that you will find all your expectations fulfilled in Jesus. And if we do that, I think God hopes that this year will have more meaning for you than any year that has gone past. And so on this Epiphany Sunday, may I encourage each of you to ask the Lord to give you, just like the wise men, a spirit of hope. Ask him to give you hope in his guidance, to give you hope through his word, and to give you the hope that comes from worshiping the Lord Jesus. It's a hope that changes and transforms the hearts and lives of ordinary people. You don't have to be a king, but ordinary people just like you and me have their lives changed by the Christ child. And just a final thought. Wise men still seek Jesus. I wonder, are you seeking him this morning?